You guys ready? Hold on.
Ready.
You guys should swap.
Oh, Lord, have mercy. I don't like
that. Yeah, finally.
I'll give you the high sign, all right?
All right. She used to be an actress.
She ever do anything I would have seen?
I think her biggest deal was she starred in a pilot.
What's a pilot?
Well, you know, the shows on TV.
I don't watch TV.
Yes, but you are aware there's an invention called television, and on that invention they show shows?
Yeah.
Well, the way they pick the shows is that they make one show, and that show is called a pilot. And they show that one show to people who pick the shows on the strength of that one show. They decide if they want to make more shows. Some get accepted and become TV programs, and some don't and become nothing. She starred in one of the ones that became nothing.
Welcome to Couch Pilots. All of you are my friends. It's the show that dares to fly into the unknown territory of awful television, pilots of the past.
That sounded like the opening of Home Improvement.
Thank you. That's the worst show ever.
What are you talking about?
I'm a JTT guy, personally.
Oh, me too.
But my name is JTT, and with me is the most modern man I know. It's Captain Philip Rest Assured. Good evening. I love you.
I love you too, buddy.
Tell me you love me again.
I do love you.
I love you.
I love you more than you know.
You're my modern man.
What? Mm? Why is that? I mean, like, I'm not very modern. Like, I don't like video games.
Right.
I don't like going out in public.
Yeah.
That's
not going out in public is the new going out in public.
It is.
But isn't the definition of modern men that we're speaking of the gropey modern men?
That's right.
So
I don't
he
grope.
Is your modern man.
I don't grope anybody except myself.
You have toxic masculinity.
buddy, it's always good to see you. You don't know how much this means to me every Monday.
Really?
Yeah. No, seriously, it does.
Okay.
It's the only reason I'm doing this. This and because Chris Tuckley put a curse on me. Other than that, I wouldn't be doing this.
What was the reason you're doing it before? Like when you were when you wanted, I guess, to do it. What was the reason before?
Because all the popularity,
all the pussy.
Yeah.
Because of all the pussy you got.
No, back in the day, I used to impress a lot of pussy because of my podcast.
Oh, yeah.
Was that ever the case?
Brian had some groupies.
No, when I was doing IBWIP.
In the early days.
You walk into a place and you're on the guest list and you go and you bring the girl over and you're like, hey, this is so-and-so, you know? And they're like, oh, that's pretty cool.
We've talked a lot about your past and your sex life, but we never talked about this. Was there a time in the early days of podcasting when there wasn't a million people doing it like there is now?
Sure, no, yeah.
Was there a time when you got laid because you're a podcast?
For sure. I,
for sure?
I,
what the fuck am I doing? What the fuck am I doing here?
There was a time that girls were very impressed and like, this was a big deal. Like you was like, you don't bring it up at first. You go on a couple dates and you go, oh, I do a podcast. I'm like, what's a podcast? I was like, well, why don't you come over Thursday night and, you just sit in and watch this.
You would invite.
Sit in the corner and watch.
So you cornered women. No, but you invite ladies over.
I can name three girls that this was probably groupies. A clincher.
But it started groupies. Out as I'm mentioning it in a bar or at a live show. I invite you over. You see me do it, and then you later lay with them biblically.
Yes, for sure.
Oh my god!
There's three girls at least during after my divorce.
Holy
three girls
guacamole.
At least.
Guacamole. That's I would say the
and
number
that's
is
why
zero
our guest. That's why one of our guests got his young lady is because he was a podcaster.
Yeah,
can you guys just go out the club, please?
Is that why you guys don't do the show like live anywhere? Because women keep throwing their underwear on the stage.
In Johnsonville, Tennessee, we did live shows.
Yeah.
There was so much pussy that we had to go to a strip club that was bad just to get away from the good looking girls.
That's right. Why don't you introduce our guests? Why don't you do that?
Ladies and gentlemen, these two folks were on last week, but they still mean as much to me as they did last week. Two great friends. We're going to start going to the Hofbräu more often. And they do amazing content. Amanda and Brian, welcome to the show.
Content creators.
Awesome.
Still no ass man.
I'm an ass man.
Burp, burp.
That was the Challenge Double Agents custom extended intro.
Custom extended.
I apologize. He's already planned this. He planned this out a long time ago.
I love it. I love the dedication. I love that he looked up stuff that's specific to
I'm amazed at
the challenge.
Yeah, I'm an ass man.
This just makes me happy.
Yeah.
I feel like I'm 16 again.
It's back when wrestling was wrestling.
Right?
Attitude era.
When you just had women in bikinis and threw shit at them.
When a professional wrestler could come out and you say, this man is billed as Mr. Ass.
Yeah. Still wrestles. I watched him wrestle on Wednesday.
He's on AEW?
Yeah.
His children are wrestling, right?
Yeah.
That's cool.
He's in a tag team with him.
He's one of those guys who's like, I'm 55, and guess what?
I still
look fucking great.
Yeah,
that's awesome.
They commented on it.
Seriously, good for him, man. That's awesome.
Let's give a shout out to AEW for like being like all around a great organization.
Big shout out.
They don't treat their talent like shit, you know? Right?
And we went to a live show a couple months ago.
Yeah, I got Brian tickets for his birthday.
Was that the Allstate Arena? Is that where that was?
No. What was it? I don't know. They go to these weird arenas I've never heard of before, but
they do a lot in Chicago, right? They're based out of Chicago?
No, they're based out of like Florida.
But they do a lot in Chicago though.
Because
CM Punk. Is CM Punk wrestling pretty regularly or is he just like kind of hanging out and then shows up on pay-per-views only?
No, he's been wrestling on a lot of the shows.
He's got to
get back into shape.
He's on every episode.
Is he a face?
For now.
Good.
He'll turn.
I really like CM Punk. Yeah. I like the guys that don't look like they're roided out. Like when who's the guy? Not Cody Rhodes, the Legend Killer. What's it?
Randy Orton.
When he first came in, the dude was like he was slender and like toned.
Yes,
and
I was wasn't just like ripped out.
Now he's kind of huge. But back then I was like that dude. He looks like a dude who's just in shape and is doing it.
Oh yeah, dude. I thought Randy Orton was hot when he first came. Now he looks like some roided out like. Nah.
What do you think about John Cena? You like him?
Dun, 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 dun,
dun. Not really. No.
There's a lot of. I do another show. We mentioned.
Is he like the most homosexual wrestler you've ever seen?
Terrible thing to say.
He's just douchey.
Brian was nice enough to ask me the other show that I did. On the last episode, it's a show about Ernest P. Worrell.
Yeah.
And there's a lot. There's some things out there floating around the web of John Cena kind of looking like Jim Varney.
Yeah.
And like how he could take up the mantle, perhaps, of Ernest.
There we go.
If they did like a WWE, if Jim Varney was still alive, they did a WWE crossover.
So the show that I do right now with Ernest was we were in contact with the people who created Ernest and wrote for him. And they gave us all this stuff that was written for Ernest, but it didn't happen.
Yeah. Okay.
And there is one in there that we've already covered about professional wrestling. I kid you not. So
that's awesome.
It is a perfect union, right? Because Ernest is kind of like a southern U.S. guy.
Yeah. And that
wrestling
was
huge down there.
Oh, yeah.
It's a perfect marriage. What do you say, Blake?
It seems like those were a same fan base.
They're scissored for each other.
Hell yeah.
Did that hurt when you did that?
Oh, yeah.
It looked painful.
You know what? If this was on video, people would be like, ow.
Let's talk about it. There's a podcasting, a physical space. You and I obviously were doing it, so we're not outside doing it. We're not animals.
Right,
But we're doing
it.
But there's another place that's not a residence that Brian and Amanda have
been working
on.
It's been hinted about for a couple of years on this podcast.
I went to go see it myself, Tim.
I wasn't invited. But
you definitely weren't.
But you were like, what a dump.
Well, no, we went there, and it was kind of just like hollowed out. It was a former business. Like, it was like a doctor's office or something,
right? Something like that.
Yeah.
And
printer sales, I think, at the end.
printer sales. Well, yeah. Well, we were there with Brian and I were there with Tim, and Tim's like, my vision is maybe like a kind of a podcasting co-op space, and Brian took that and ran with it.
Well, all three of us did.
Can you guys talk about that a little bit? What your intentions are with the space, what you've done so far, and what you want to see happen there?
Yeah.
I do some writing for JoeBlow.com, and I approached them about doing some stuff. So that kind of spurred us because we've been talking about it forever. And I kept asking, like, well, like if we build a space, are we going to use it, or is it going to be like, I don't want to drive to the studio. Right. Let's just do it from our house or whatever.
Right.
We wondered about, you know,
my pajamas are on. Let's just do it. Yeah.
But we pushed through. We ended up installing a bunch of stuff. We got a bunch of equipment.
Multiple cameras set up. So
to help push us, we updated one of our Patreon tiers to a video tier. So now we have video episodes accompanying our regular episodes.
For challenged. Is that challenged only?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And then we're pushing to do some more stuff. I got some ideas for some other shows we're going to do. And
so a lot of this stuff sounds like it's Brian-centric.
Yeah.
The idea when we talked to Tim was like, what if we create a community space? You know, maybe they give us X amount per month. They can come and use the studio. We'll give them access. We'll kind of monitor who's coming in and out to make sure it makes sense. Is that part of your plan?
That's not part of my vision. That's a big part of Tim's vision.
Okay.
But I just want a space for all of, like, for us
for
to
our
use
friends
and
yeah, any of our podcasting friends. Like, we want to just instead of it be like a rentable, usable space. Like, for now, especially until it's, you know, something that's more formal. I mean, right now it's what is in front of the camera looks decent, but everything else looks like a construction site. So it's like right now it's like, we just want to offer it, you know, kind of, and have people come up with ideas that are friends of ours and use it however they can use it.
Almost like this is a good way for us to work out the kinks of everything.
To get to something like that.
And then if we get to something where it's rentable or put out to the community, then, you know, that's
what you guys are saying is that it's pretty like porn ready, right?
Yeah.
For me,
it's totally porn ready. You bring your own soiled mattress, it's good to go.
Yeah, there's plenty of rooms. Like, you could easily set up a room. And
so it's like a jungle fluffer room.
Like, you're going to high-five that shit.
You know what's funny is that, like, I look at this place now, and I used to go, like, when I was a kid in high school, there was this place downtown Peoria, this sketchy old building in downtown Peoria. It was like a drug den, really.
The place that you were at.
That I used to hang out at, like, or I would go with friends. I don't really know. It was basically like a drugged in, but it felt like this studio space now that I think about it, because it was a bunch of smaller rooms, you know what I mean?
Right.
And most of them didn't have doors, much like this space where they don't have doors because you know it's been scavenged.
We gotta get those doors in there.
I think it was basically a vacant building that people had taken over. And like, yeah, we had I met somebody down there that had like one of the rooms like set up with couches, and like we were smoking pot down there. I mean, when I was in high school.
Is this just like a vacant building that none of you broke in and hung out in?
I think that a whole bunch of people did. Okay. I mean, I went down there a handful of times.
Yeah.
How many handfuls?
Maybe three.
Okay.
Like, I want to go down to this place where people are loading up smack, and I want to smoke some pot.
I mean, it was weird. You know what I mean? But like, thinking back on it, at the time when I was a kid, I just was like,
sketchy.
This is crazy. And you're just like doing it because you're like, you're just,
there was no fans only back then. But I envision the place you guys,
but now
a fans only place right now.
That's like, that's not a bad idea.
You can rent these spaces out for fans only people that are doing
stuff.
To do
their little fans only videos.
Blake, how many times have you gone to...
And I
want to
be a security guard.
Hold on. How many times have you gone to xhamster.com and you put in...
10,000.
You put Bobby socks in there. And it'll send you to where you want to go. But before you get there, it'll take you to like...
The live
jazz or something. And it's very clearly... It's supposed to look like a bedroom.
Oh, yeah.
But it's someone...
It's just some room.
In Croatia somewhere in this cold building.
Warehouse
bean.
There's like stations, you know it.
Why can't we do that here?
So Brian, I'm saying to you and Amanda, what are your moral standards.
Brian,
money or moral standards?
Brian, can we have fuck pad, Brian? Oh, I have fuck pad at your place, Brian?
You bring your own solid mattress and just do it when I'm not there. You do whatever you want.
Technically not in our name, so go for it.
I'm going to bring a blanket. I'm not going to bring a soiled mattress.
I don't
I'm
give
bring
a fuck
blanket.
If it's soiled or not. We're putting a fitted sheet. We're putting a flat sheet over it, then a comforter.
And then we're putting up some like LED strobe lights.
Yes, that's exactly right.
So we pretty much have like $1 million idea here. Yeah.
I listen to a lot of podcasts, and some of them are I forgive you. A lot of them are mainstream, where it's like it's a big network, and some of them have studio spaces.
Sure.
But I would say the overwhelming majority of podcasts out there don't get a ton of downloads, and they're doing it out of their house.
Yeah.
I can't tell you, just in the limited experience of the past 8-9 years that I've had podcasting, people coming to me and say, hey, got a great idea for a podcast. I'm like, okay, cool. When are you going to do it? It's like, I don't know anything about it. This is what that space is.
Right.
It's saying, do you have an idea? We can help you with the equipment and the setup and the editing. We can teach you how to do it.
Mm-hmm.
Same could be said, I guess, for doing homemade porno like Blake.
Right. But we can show you how to do that.
But there really could be, as we were joking about last episode, this nation is just almost creating unskilled folks who are creating content, whether that be masturbating or talking into a mic.
Right.
Why not create a space where people are paying to come use that stuff on a monthly basis?
Yeah, exactly. Because really, I mean, we've all kind of just helped each other out with questions and things over
and content
the years.
In general. It's just like, you know.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, I know that Brian and you don't like to hang out with me, but you're like willing to.
I love it.
Wrong.
So, but the footage I've seen. You said it earlier, we concentrate on this one space and we made it look popping.
Yeah.
The rest of it looks like a fucking crack den. But this one space looks great. I love it. I heard about it not too long ago. I heard about you guys doing going and doing stuff with it. And I said to Jason, let's see if we can just hang out there for a couple hours.
Weasel is the word you were used.
I said weasel. Because I love the band.
He said I wanted to weasel my way.
Yeah, I love the band Weasel. Mm-hmm. And
what days of the week you guys like? Wednesdays or Saturdays? We're there both days.
we're a Monday crowd. We're kind of a Monday crowd.
I'm fairly open. Blake has got like 6 days.
I know he's got
between bowling and the moose. It's hard to pin him down.
Well, now I have a child who is really good at bowling, and so now we're filling up my days of the week with him bowling.
Yes.
And I'm like, you know, and my wife. Is
my wife
my wife is quitting her second job to go back to her old second job, and so
Kohl's or PetSmart?
PetSmart. Petco, by the way. Ooh, sorry.
You get discount on food at the Petco.
You know what?
Well, get beat later.
The other day,
you got two giant ass dogs.
The other day, she's like, I'm going to go to Petco to get food. I was like, oh, I'll go. She goes, no. Yeah. We have a free bag of food coming, and I'm like, oh, 70 pounds of free food. You go. And find it.
When you have two horses like that, any discount on the...
Agreed,
No, for sure.
That's for sure.
Smart move.
Are you still in the phase, Brian, where you're like, you're pumped and excited about this?
Yes.
Good.
We'll see. That'll go away eventually.
It all does, but hopefully
What will make you continue to have that feeling?
No, I don't know.
It's got to be money and engagement.
As if, I was going to say me and you.
Or an interview. Oh, well, you and
you
I
too.
Are the engagement
couch
part
pilots. That's what.
Well, it is. It's engagement, and it's like we do things just because we want to hang out with people. Like, and it doesn't even have to make money. Like,
believe me, I don't fucking care about this show, but I want to hang out.
If the podcast studio means that we all can get together once every 2 weeks or whatever it is,
under
and
the guise
hang out,
of a podcast,
then I'd say
if it happens, it's fine.
Win, you know, like it doesn't, that's enough. Like, and that's enough for a long time. It doesn't have to make money. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Especially when someone else is flipping the bill for the building, right?
Yes, exactly, exactly.
I will give you guys $100 if we can do 2 episodes of
Couch Pilots.
You're
not paying us any money.
No, that's not what I'm saying.
Okay.
I will give you guys $100 if we can do 2 episodes of Couch Pilots where somebody else is running everything and it's posted. Is that, can we do that?
Oh, it's posted?
Even someone else running the board?
Oh, right, Jason Pace
no,
run
just
the board.
No, just the video board. Can we make that verbal contract?
Brian, he's your man.
Brian, say yes
or
no.
Would you do it?
We'll there
you
go. Yes.
No.
Yes.
100%.
Okay. All right.
100%.
Hey, Jason, you owe Brian $100.
Zoinks. Let's. I got one other question I had for this episode. This one's for Amanda. I'm a single guy.
Yeah.
And
right in front of me? Jesus.
Wow. Jesus.
What a dick.
I mean, I'm an asshole. But that was a
You've
super...
seen the new ring, right? I'm pretty sure that
there's
this...
There's a new ring?
I'm pretty sure that everybody is, like, massively, like, once they see it, they just, like, run away because they realize that...
It's an updated ring from the original?
It is, but it's an heirloom ring. So that's my grandmother's...
That's what new ring means.
Right? Yeah, it's new.
No, I just want to make sure. That's amazing.
Yeah.
That's
amazing.
Oh, trust me, I didn't pop for it. So.
Who did?
Big and blingin'.
She did.
She bought her own fucking ring?
No, I paid for the original engagement ring.
Right.
She bought her wedding bands, but this is an upgraded ring that has the stones of her mom's wedding ring and her grandma's wedding ring combined together.
And all in one.
So you provided the material and you paid instead of you provided the material.
Well, we paid. We have a joint account.
Our money is our money. Our money is our money.
Really?
Always has been.
They're in what is commonly called a lasting relationship.
You know what? To be honest with you, correct me, I'm not used to that.
Blake says, right. I'm in love with you. I want to do a podcast with you. I merely say I'm single and I'm a fucking pariah.
Correct.
Hear me out.
Yes.
What I'm getting at is I recently came across this. I wish for the life of me I could remember where this came from. But it was something where like a lady was saying to her husband, I don't want you to hang out with a single guy. A single guy would be a bad influence on you. But I don't know. I don't think it was directed towards me. I feel like I just picked it up somewhere, and I just like applied it to myself. I was like, I wonder if that is happening in my life at all.
Sure it is, actually. Okay. I'm to tell you the truth.
All right. Well, what I want to say to you is...
Can you press the unanimous button?
Thank you for that. I guess what I would ask you is that would you allow Brian to hang out with a single friend, a male, of course.
Yeah.
Or would you consider that a bad influence?
No, he can absolutely hang out with any of his single friends.
But what I'm saying, you have heard before?
Oh yes. Well, there's a lot of people.
I don't know about that. Please explain that to me.
I have several friends who have husbands who have friends who are like of the big drinking and go out and meet girls, like, and that's all they want to do. So if you send your husband out with them, is that all they're doing is just drinking and picking up girls? Like, that's what it's more about single guys who only want to do that.
Hold on, Blake wants to make this about
notes.
Him.
Can you, what are those dudes' names and phone numbers? Because I really want to do that.
That's not my MO.
No, but if that's, you know what I mean? Like if you, like, so I had friends whose husbands had friends like that. And that's what it was.
And their wives actively were trying to get them away from them.
So then it just became all single people. Yeah, all single guys, you know, because there were a couple bad eggs. But yeah, okay. I've heard it from multiple different
women. You know about this, Brian?
See, I thought this question was going in the other direction where it would be... Would I have a problem with her hanging out with a single male friend?
No, that's already out there. Like, people can say whatever they want. Two heterosexual people of opposite sexes cannot hang out together. You cannot.
Why? I'm so over it. I hate that. I really do.
Do you have male friends?
I did. Like, okay. Well, and I mean, really, like, all of...
Until I told him to get the fuck out of my house.
I mean, but when we used to do, or when Brian did Drunken Zombie with all of the boys...
Yeah, yeah.
I have hung out with all of those boys by myself.
Okay.
And... It ain't
Why
no thing.
Why is Brian letting that happen? Like,
well, okay. Well, here's the thing. Let me ask you this.
And I've always had guy friends.
I only walked in on a gangbang once, all right?
It bugs me when people are like, no, you can't.
Well, give her some water.
You were
Brian her a bottle of water.
You are blind on one side. Let me ask you this. Sure. All those people that you would hang out with, you say one-on-one, which is an important distinction to make.
Sure.
Did you want to be with those guys romantically?
No.
Okay. They wanted to be with you romantically.
No, they didn't.
Absolutely.
How do you know?
Because that is the only way it goes. It is 100%.
I have had so many guy friends. Well, here
I forgot to ask one.
Jason, you forgot to ask the one thing.
Were they gay?
They were not gay. But I was also like everybody's big fat friend, Jason. Like, you know what I mean? Like, it's a different, you know?
There is, I guess, exceptions that prove the rule,
but I
100% stand behind what I say. I think if we dig on YouTube, Blake and Brian, you would agree with me.
Yes.
Two heterosexual people of opposite gender cannot be friends one-on-one without one or the other wanting to sleep with each other. It does not happen.
Yeah.
This is the Meg Ryan, Billy Crystal...
Meg Ryan, John Mellencamp.
Well, I mean, I don't want to hang out with these people all the time by myself. Most of the time it's together. But if there's something that happens like, oh, I like going to this kind of concert and you like that kind of music and let's go do that together one time.
And Brian would let that happen.
Like, I don't
He would stay home for a Foo Fighters concert and
not
you would
a
go.
Foo
no, not Foo Fighters. No. They're one of my favorite bands. But like a hippie band.
Like if I wanted to go see like a jam band or a hippie band play and like I had Fish. Like our buddy Randy, he you know was big into hippie music, and like him and I would do that kind of stuff together.
I heard Randy owns zero pairs of shoes. Is that right?
He owns shoes. True.
Okay, so thank you for bringing that up, but that is old news as far as I'm concerned, dead and buried subject. But my new concern and the new thing that I learned is that married ladies do not want their husbands hanging out with single guys. But you're saying it's only. For guys who are kind of classic dogs.
Douchebags. Yeah.
Douchebags.
Yeah, those douchebags.
Blake, would you consider me a douchebag?
No.
I don't think so.
Because you're single and my wife lets me hang out with you every other Monday.
Well, you do it in the confines.
Of your house. You don't go out anywhere.
As long as you do it in the basement, I don't care.
Well, he doesn't invite me to go anywhere else.
But, well, I'm not a strip club guy. I do like going to bars, but I'm never like trying to like get in some lady's pants.
Yeah,
now, if I had ladies approach me, sure. But I'm not out there. Yeah. I'm not poon hounded.
You're not like just at the bar, like putting the pickup line on every girl that walks up.
So much so that when Blake first met me, he thinks, I think Jason's a gay guy.
I thought he was gay for a long time.
When someone's this handsome and this clean and organized, of course he's a gay guy.
Yeah.
Right. My bachelor party is when I decided I didn't like strip clubs anymore.
Tell me about that. Oh, we may have discussed this on episode 200, actually, but please hit us again. Do you remember that? We had him on here. We did a five-hour episode. We talked about strip clubs.
Yeah, we did.
Hit us, Brian.
It was my bachelor party. And, of course, if you go to a strip club, you have to have at least one lap dance.
Sure,
otherwise, what are you fucking even doing there?
That's right.
Exactly right. He was sitting there in a chair in front of a stage. Ugh.
But I'm very particular. I got to zero in on the one I want, creepily. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, what's the point?
I'm with you. I am with you right now.
I'm not getting a lap dance from just anybody.
Yeah, you're not going to give your hard-earned money to just any little whore bag.
A couple of weeks ago, Tim told us the kind of lady he was into.
Yeah.
Look what happened.
Well, no, I was directing that towards you.
But yeah, he wants to know. Yeah,
it's a good deflect, right?
What you looking for?
No, so I mean, I don't know. I found the only girl I felt who was even remotely attractive in club cabaret.
Long pubic hair, very long,
you braided. Right, but what are you looking for in this girl?
It wasn't what I was looking for. It was like, who do I think's the hottest one here?
That's what I mean. But what's the hottest girl look like?
Well, she did something. She had a bunch of like peacock feathers.
Oh,
all right, okay.
So almost an animal.
No. It just she didn't look like she had a meth problem like a lot of the other ones in there. That's kind of what it came down to.
We're looking for normies. That's what we're looking for.
And I realized about halfway through that I'm like. Realistically, how old I am and how old she is, I could be her dad.
Oh, right. Mercy.
Yeah. And that's when I realized, oh, no, I just ruined it. I can't ever go to a strip club again. So
we just talked about a business opportunity with this podcast space and bringing in people to do that. Is there an opportunity for old strippers
to come in and do a podcast?
Well, no,
old people like you.
Brian's like, do you want to do a podcast? You want to do a podcast?
You want to do older strippers?
Well, if you find them attractive.
Well, you felt creepy with a young lady doing that. I could be your father. Well, what if we got people your own age?
As long as they were attractive.
There you go.
I don't want a random uggo just rubbing up on me.
They got to show you their ID before they start.
Yeah, because my bachelor party, when we first got there, some crazy old lady... was like, oh, hey, how's it going? You want to dance? And, you know, pulls her boobs out and they just fall down to her knees. And I was like, we just got here. I think we're just settling in. We'll talk to you later.
I have notorious for going to strip clubs and instead of like, hey, dear beautiful lady.
Insert name here.
Give me some money and we'll dance. I have a tendency just to start interviewing them.
Interviewing them.
And then...
You ask them 50 million
questions? No, I sit and talk to them. Like, they're earning their money, like, talking to
me. Right, yeah.
And then I, like, then I decide, okay, are you interesting enough? And
are you interesting?
This is real. This is not a bit. There was one time I talked to this girl for a half hour, 45 minutes. We went back and, you know, sat down in the, I sat down in the cushiony leather chair or whatever. And I said something, of course, because I have to always be talking as she plants down on my jaja. And I say something to make her laugh. And so for 15 minutes of the song, we're just laughing.
I was sounds like, very bleak.
It does. I paid her $45 just to laugh with me for 20 minutes. I was like, I can laugh at myself when I pull this.
That's
thing.
That's what I do now. That's why
I'm it's gonna make all of you real mad is that when you're a girl, I've never paid for lap dance.
I've never paid for lap dance.
And like plenty of girls have like flipped around like out like. When you're a girl, like you're just sitting in
they
the.
They love girls.
They
coming.
Love
they love,
it.
They want it.
You can just literally sit in a chair. And
the first
just
thing,
like,
they, the first thing they do
like
is
moth to a flame.
The first thing they do is they get on top of you and they nibble your ear. That's the first thing they do. That's the first thing.
It's
they do.
Usually that hot breath. They do that weird like. Ooh. Thing. In
your, how was that again? Ear. How was it again? Oh yeah, I love that hot breath.
Love hot breath. Ooh, baby. Oh,
still have more stripper stories.
Hashtag rot.
You got one more?
It's a long one, though. You're gonna
do it. Yeah, strip clubs are like gambling to me. They don't do anything for me. Sometimes I wish, though, they did. Sometimes no. I wish I could like go to a strip club and
we had a lot of fun when we were young. Like, when we were young and you'd be like wasted and like for some
when
reason we would play rock band.
When was
and
last
we
time
like
the two of you went to a strip club? God.
Been a long time.
Three,
long
time. 4 weeks.
Big Al's was still downtown.
Yeah, it was still uptown.
That's a long time.
Up downtown.
Up downtown, yeah. But yeah, it's been a long time. I have no idea.
Blake was just like a year ago.
I've been to Big Al's since, and he's been since.
I've been to the new one once.
But we haven't been together.
Yeah, I went on my bachelor
she's so
party.
About that.
It
she's
was
like,
terrible.
No, I went down. They had a mail review.
Oh, thank you for finishing that sentence.
I went down to
Thunder?
Big Al's.
Thunder from Down Under?
One of those. I don't know what it was. One of those. So Magic Mike XL. Like... It was Magic Mike Tour. That's what it was. That's what it was.
These announcers are doing a third movie. So
oh,
yeah.
Are
Lord
they really?
Have mercy. Yeah.
At my age, I'm like, listen, I work hard for the money that
that's
I have.
Right. That's exactly right.
Yes, I agree.
And I would rather put it in a slot machine
you'd rather
and try
drink.
To win.
You'd rather drink
or drink it away than this girl rubbing on me who in 5 minutes from now is going to walk away and, you know, she doesn't care.
Right?
That slot machine cares about me.
Or that drink will help you go nai-nai.
Well, I mean,
I love that drink. You can make it go nai-nai.
You can probably just put those quarters in that slot and see if it works for a strip club, too.
Holy hell. If you get a couple cherries, I think you're golden, brother. Mm. Today we discuss the pilot episode of Modern Men.
Oh, is that what we're doing?
What?
That was a song I played, too, by Arcade Fire called Modern Man. Not bad. Pretty good song. Anyway.
Yeah. Rockin'.
That pilot's from the year of our Lord, 2006. And I'll tell you this, pretty good year, 2006. Blake disagrees.
I'm trying to do the math. I don't think 2006 was good.
I was 25.
I was 31.
And my daughter 26. Was a year old at that point.
Aww.
Mm-hmm. She's a great gal. I think I was in the midst of a divorce.
But isn't that good, though? Because every time I date a lady who's, like, separated or going through a divorce...
You got to keep her separated.
She's there's a lot of fucking going on. So was that you're probably...
I did a lot of fucking afterwards.
You're probably nuts deep in fucking.
Yeah, because I was... Like, this is... Well, no, because this was a year before I started podcasting. So I was married at this time. No, I was married at this time. It sucked.
IBWIP established 2007.
2007, that's yeah. Right. I just got to look at the shirt over there.
Yeah. What about either of you have a good year 2006?
Yeah, it was a good year. We went to Vegas in 2006.
We did?
That was the big Vegas road trip.
Did you guys see the Blue
Ska
Man Group?
Circus? No, we went to a ska festival.
Who played there? Boston's?
Real Big Fish.
Okay.
The Mighty Mighty.
Voodoo Glow Skulls.
Don't know them.
Yeah.
Scatolites.
Rocket from the Crypt, were they there?
Maybe.
Okay.
Don't know.
But yeah, it was super fun. But yeah, it was a really fun year. It was like one of the first years we, dated. I was working at the hospital with, a bunch of girls my own age, and like we were going out every night, like in our scrubs, like we ruled the world. Like we were,
this is when she'd get off work at 11 and we'd go out and I'm at home sleeping.
Oh, it was the best.
I dated a nurse for a while.
Yeah.
And she would say, in my class, out of 100 ladies, there's like three or four guys. And I think those are the smartest men in the world. Because honestly, out of those guys, probably one, maybe two gay guys. And the other guy is just like, he's got pussy on the calendar. And I'm sorry to be so rude. I usually don't speak like that. But like that
dude. See
your
clutch of pearls? Like, oh my.
That's the smartest thing I've ever heard. If you're a young guy trying to get laid, why not try to become a nurse and be surrounded by smoking hot broads?
Worst things to do with your life.
I totally agree. My God.
Smoking hot broads that want to take care of people. Mm-hmm. They want to take care of you, Jason. You know what I mean? Like, people, women that work in healthcare, I mean, they want to take care of people.
And I was dating that nurse. You want to take care of
her? Yeah, right? I mean,
Blake remembers her.
A giver. They're givers. Let's just.
Then she wanted to check your prostate every night.
That's fine. What? Don't shame that.
I'm not joking. We won't say her name, but there were multiple times, and I think it was carried over from our previous relationship where she was like, do you want me to like stick my fingers in your asshole?
Yeah.
And I was like, I don't.
I'm good. I think I'm okay.
But I've heard gay guys talk about it. Like, if you are a straight fella and you've never been pegged or had something put in your bunghole, you're missing out because it's the greatest fucking orgasm. And so this lady was like, hey, why don't I do that for you? And I'm like, still like that. I'm fine with what's happening already.
Just puts the glove on.
Yeah. Blake has been strangely quiet during this segment. Yeah. Let's go back to 2006.
In our minds.
And to do so, we'll talk about some things that happened specifically in the UK, because these are all UK pilots that we're doing, and we got to get in the mind frame, right, Blake, of these pilots?
Damn right.
It's rubbish. Mate.
Bunch of bullshit.
Blake, I'm about to tell people what happened in that year. But you're usually pretty good about telling us about some things we didn't have at that time, though, right?
Oh, yeah. In 2006, there's a lot of things we didn't have.
Sometimes you got to push Blake along.
You know what?
He's like, what? Tired.
I was completely enamored by Amanda being here. I completely forgot last episode.
And enamored, of course, is a word in the English language.
Hammered.
In 2006.
Armored? Or?
I think you meant to say, I'm hammered.
In 2006, we did not have a GoFundMe.
Correct.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
You couldn't make any money. We also
just ask random strangers for money.
Yeah, we didn't have Pornhub in 2006. Right. Mm-hmm. We didn't have, which it's. Amanda, I'm going to tell you this. Brian, I'm going to tell you this. And when you hear it, you're going to be like, no fucking way. But in 2006, we didn't have any Band-Aids. There was no such thing as Band-Aids, okay? And in 2006, also, we didn't have tampons with wings.
I've heard about, like, pads with wings, but tampons with wings.
I guess it's that absorbable
fuck me,
cord.
Right?
Fuck you,
it's
buddy.
That absorbable cord. Braided cord for extra absorbency he's talking about there.
Let me rephrase that.
Braided cords.
People were soaking them in vodka and shoving.
A double-headed tampon is what it was.
You had to put a tampon. Wait.
What's that?
By the end of the show, he's going to turn into Arnold Schwarzenegger from Total Recall. He's going to be like, ah, 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 ah.
I thought you were going to say he would have three tits by the end of the show.
Well, that too.
December 7th, a tornado hits London.
Oh, what? Wow. How is that possible?
Is it virtually unprecedented to have a tornado hit a major metropolitan area?
Usually the buildings break up the airflow, but it has been known to happen a couple times.
That's insane.
That's why I always say, like, we live in Peoria proper. Like, I don't worry about tornadoes.
Well,
but, you know, you kind of should,
I guess. Never really been affected by a tornado. I know Blake has, for sure. Mm-hmm. Right? We've talked about that ad nauseum.
Recently, it was based off of the recording date, it was not too far away.
How so?
No, I'm saying
it's coming.
The anniversary of it.
Okay. Yeah, you had to move as a result of it. It tore up your house, and then thankfully you moved back in, and then you bought a place. But Brian, in all of your travels, have you ever been affected, or have you even seen a tornado in person?
Never seen one. I used to work at WEK.
Oh,
and they had
a
tornado sort of run through the parking lot.
That
damaged a couple trees.
That was the infamous one that erased a line through Washington, Illinois.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I was watching that.
Yeah, that was the same.
Were you watching by chance the news when that happened?
No, that was the same one that happened to us.
Yeah, it was the same day. It might not have been the same one.
It was the same tornado.
Same storm system, right? Yeah. I remember I was in my home, and I live in a valley, and I was watching WEK, and I remember them saying, is a terrible storm's happening right now, so much so that we're actually going to stop doing the news. Mm-hmm. And like they just went to the what's the thing where it's just
bunker.
No, that you see on TV. It used to be an Indian guy with
the test pattern.
Yeah, it went to like test pattern because they're like, well, we're reporting how horrible this is, but it is here where we are doing this news and we're stopping the news now. I remember seeing that live. Terrifying.
Yeah, that's crazy.
That's when I turned off my TV, and my mom lives down the street, so I went down to her house and we went in the basement.
Good idea.
Good job.
Bizarre day.
Good idea.
Bizarre day. Yeah. December 29th of that year, the British government pays off the Anglo-American loan made in 1946. Was the loan made to the United Kingdom by the United States on July 15th on 1946, enabling its economy in the Second World War to keep afloat? Blake, are you crippled by debt?
Yes, for sure.
Yeah, we all are as Americans. For sure. Right? It's our American way.
It's American way. If you're not in debt. Actually, a lot of times my wife says, I want to buy this. And I said, no. And she's like, well, the people down the street have this.
Keep it up with the Joneses.
And I'm like, she goes, how do they do it? I say, how do they do that? And she goes, they get on credit. And I'm like, but I don't want to do that. And she's like, well, that's why I want a divorce.
What is an example of something that she's wanted to buy that would be crippling debt for you credit card-wise?
An RV, trailer, camper.
Where would you even put that? Does she not think of these things?
No, she doesn't think ahead.
Should we call her? Right?
No, we should not call her.
I've heard if you start breaking stuff down, not into dollars, but how many hours you have to work to afford it, puts it in better perspective.
Well,
some people.
And that's very true. But a lot of times I'm like,
but whose dollars?
Well,
my dollars.
Well, like okay,
your dollars.
So my brother this year bought a camper on a campsite, right?
Mm-hmm.
So he paid $20,000 for this camper and has to pay $1,000 a year.
Yeah.
And there's three or four of them that are for sale around him.
Mm-hmm.
And my wife says, why don't we get one? And I was like, we live in Illinois.
Where are these campers?
It's Victoria,
right?
Victoria, Illinois. Okay. Knox
County. It's in Illinois, so it's close.
And
40
so
minutes away.
I said, right now, me and you both work two jobs a week. you work every Friday night, and I work every Saturday. When would we use this trailer? And she's like, well, we can stop doing that. I was like, but then
but
not after we
money.
Buy the trailer.
But then how do you pay for the trailer?
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah,
so, you know, my brother took out of his retirement to buy it.
Sure.
And he has no friends. So it's perfect for him, right?
Yeah, right?
But we don't have that much retirement built up.
Mm-hmm.
And we have friends. So why would we do that?
Yeah. But maybe you're not thinking of it right. From now on, every Monday, you're doing the podcast around a campfire at your new campsite.
Oh.
Ooh.
Hey, Jason, do you want to drive an hour and a half to come podcast?
Uh-uh. Amanda, you have anything that you want to do that would, like, if I did this, I know we'd be in debt about forever? Like a trip or
an RV?
Oh,
yeah. I would love to take some kind of international trip.
Where would you want to go? Europe? You gotta go to Europe, right?
UK, right?
Europe, if I only could pick, if I could pick one place, I think I would have to go Europe. I also, though, I love Asia, the terracotta soldiers I've always wanted to see. Some of the national art, like wonders of the world are kind of pretty impressive to me, like the pyramids. I would really like to see the pyramids. Mm-hmm. And
Well, they're not a natural wonder.
Well, not natural. I changed that. I stopped that. I cut it off. Did you hear me?
Amanda said something stupid.
Typical. This is right.
I have a tiny terracotta soldier on my sink.
Yes.
For about 10 years now.
That's fabulous. I love the terracotta soldiers. I think it's so neat that they're all different, you know. And
They were buried for a long time, right?
Yes.
They were created to, like, protect an old leader of China or something?
Yeah,
like?
It's basically in his tomb. You know, he had this army built basically out of the likeness of real soldiers to protect him in the afterlife.
You can't,
because they have the afterlife that they believe in, unlike a lot of us Christians.
Isn't it you have to go underground to see them? It's like in a big glass thing where you can't interact with
yeah.
them.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But I think you can walk around the edge and they're like, you know, they've excavated and so you can see right down in on top of them. And then I think they have pulled some up.
Boy, that'd be nuts,
out.
Wouldn't it?
But it's,
holy cow.
It would just be so cool.
Brian, you ready to flip that bill and go into debt?
I was going to say, no. Brian is online getting those tickets. Yeah.
No.
Right. Hey, he did give me tickets to Key West, though, for our anniversary.
Ooh.
So we're going to Key West in April.
So I put us minutely in debt for that.
That'd be fun, though. What are you guys going to do down there, you know?
Drink?
We're going to beach it. We're going to do some outdoor activities.
You ever been parasailing?
Yeah. I have when I was younger.
We'll see.
But I want to go.
But they
got
Netflix here.
I want to go kayaking through the mangroves. They've got the mangroves and stuff. I want to go kayaking through there. They have snorkeling. So they have a national park that's like an island.
Tortuga.
Yes, it looks so freaking cool.
And also with you, thank you.
It looks so cool.
I heard it's cool. I heard people you can camp there if you.
Yes,
want.
You can. Yeah. Yeah, you can take stuff and camp there. I've kind of read about it too. But yeah, it looks really neat. So I'd like to take a ferry.
It's
over.
An old military base, or something, right?
Yeah. That too. Yeah.
Yeah, that'd be awesome.
I'll even take.
Spending a week
too.
Down there in April.
I want to see some drag queens too.
Hell yeah!
I'm part of that shit.
Well, that sounds like an awesome trip.
Love yes! me some bitches with dicks.
I'll have to have them on after the trip. Finally, December 21st, Steve Wright is charged with the Ipswich prostitute murders.
Stephen Wright? The comedian?
It is funny. Yeah. While Tom Stevens is released on bail pending further inquiries, this concludes a month-long investigation into five murders committed. Amanda, when will sex work be legal? Those are my notes. I don't know.
When will sex work be legal?
I remember that. I think we did that last Tuck Lieutenant. I think
did
we
really?
Did. Right. I think we did him last Tuck Lieutenant.
I feel like, you know, if people could just be more empowered and less of the negative and, like, people controlling, if it was more of a from a positive kind of standpoint.
Well, how about this? Brian should
get rid of pimps.
Yeah.
Get rid of pimps.
That's it. Pimps is the big problem.
Pimps, hoes are fine. Pimps are not fine.
Pimping is almost too easy.
God, it's so easy. Brian,
it should be legal because I don't understand why. Be
you
like, well, I want
to
have sex
with
someone. They said if I pay them, I can do it. I don't understand why
that's
okay if you record it on film, but it's not okay just to do it in life.
If I can make horseshoes for a horse,
why can't
because
I make
I chose to do it because I'm good at it.
Right?
Why can't I spread them legs apart?
Yeah,
and that guy fuck me.
And Brian's exactly right. Why can you film it? And it's okay, but if
you
don't film it, it's not.
I say we do some more filming.
Between consenting adults and the medical and the security there, why not? Fuck your brains.
Right.
Who gives a shit?
Yeah.
It takes 3 seconds to find out if you have an STD.
Mm-hmm.
Back in the day, it was longer.
I need whatever you found that for, my need for context.
No, I'm just saying, like, testing is, there's rapid testing for everything, right?
There's still send-off.
But, like, why do we choose to watch it?
They still call you later when you have that stuff done at the doctor's office, don't they?
They do it right there. They do it right there.
Well, porn has regulations where you have to get tested at least, like, once a month or something.
That's
so
great.
I don't know why
that's
you
great.
Couldn't do it for sex workers.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Why do we choose to watch?
Xhamsters.com is the best.
Why do we choose to watch this, Blake?
There's four criteria for this season. One, it was free.
Ooh, yeah.
Number two, it was a pilot that never went to series. We had to find it on the interwebs.
Awesome!
And the big one, it was a UK pilot from Chris Tuckley. Thank you. Thank you, everybody. Can I have some more applause, please? Thank you, thank you, thank you. I appreciate it. As drunk as I am, I did a really good job. So.
We can find the entire episode of Modern Men by subscribing to Couch Pilots on SoundCloud, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, or your favorite podcast, Apple Choice, and then simply click on one of our classically blue links in our show notes, or go to YouTube. We'll do it, Blake, this time.
You know what to do, tube. You thought you'd catch me, didn't you?
Flight attendants, prepare for takeoff, please.
Bing bong to the skies.
It's a beautiful night. It's a beautiful
clear
night.
Clear skies. I can see Orion's belt.
Amanda, I'm going to ask you. I'm going to ask Brian the same question. So, Brian, pay attention. When you take a flight on Couch Pilots, how smooth is it?
It depends. It depends on how much.
How much
that captain?
How much
has had to drink?
The captain rest assures on your shoulders, I think, right?
Brian,
you always a smooth flight, smooth as silk.
Good job, guys. Like both of the answers, they were completely opposite, but I loved them both.
Summary of the Pilot, a sitcom set in Victorian London. Like,
that's a D?
A D.
Yeah, it's just like a comedy in Victorian England. There's no...
Brian, you want to grade this? You don't have to.
No, he does. He has to.
Brian, you have to grade it.
Well, I mean, maybe I'd go C minus.
C minus? Okay, this is
because I mean, technically...
That's close to a D.
Because technically, you're correct. But I do feel like there's more to it. Correct.
Yeah, this grade, I feel like, has always been more of a gut feeling rather than technicality.
Yeah, guttural. It is.
Amanda? It's a good grade.
Yeah, I C minus seems to be my...
Yeah, you're a tough grader.
How about you, Jason?
I refrain from the grading. I will not do it. I will... You cannot
you have
twist
to.
My... Absolutely. I've never done it. I will never do it.
Amanda, twist his arm right now. Twist his arm right now.
Not behind the back, please!
How do you grade Captain Blake's drinking tonight?
Yeah. Oh, boy. He's a grade A alcoholic. Variety, they say, is a spice of life. So I try to get friends from all different parts of life. And I say, I've dated ladies who are mentally ill. Yeah. Why can't I have a good friend that's an alcoholic? That's Blake.
Good choice.
Interesting facts is my choice.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the show. Part of the show where Jason scours the internet and has Chris Tuckley email him facts about this show that you may not know. Chris Tuckley has done all the work. His wife and kids had time without him just so you can have these facts. And Jason enjoys the fact that he had a couple days off. Can you play my Osiris? I'm going to play my Osiris. My Osiris. Thank you.
She's a beautiful girl, isn't she?
Okay.
You guys ever hear that song before?
Can I put a timeout on here?
Please. She sounds like she needs her nose cleaned out, though.
Put a timeout.
Timeout. So Molly says, what do you want for Christmas?
Are you crying?
A lot of times I do.
He's got self-work.
I cry a lot of the time.
You got moisture on this side of your face. I'm just checking.
He's a fucking crybaby.
Miley Cyrus, I love her.
I love her so much.
So Molly says, what do you want for Christmas? And I said, I want a pair of Miley Cyrus sweatpants. Okay?
Excuse me.
Wait for it. I'll let you guys get there.
Okay.
So then I go on she goes, I don't know, what do they look like?
Yeah.
So I go on her website, and on the back where the butt is, it says, fuck. And on each leg, on one leg it says Miley, and on the other side it says Cyrus. And these sweatpants are
$70. $70? Oh my God. That's ridiculous.
That's how much I love Miley.
Does Blake make Molly wear like a wig and play like Hannah Montana?
No, she won't do it. I tried.
Yeah. Yes, it does.
8 months ago, I tried last time I had sex.
But come on, do it and then go out of the room and come back in as Miley.
No, to be honest with you, when I listen to Spotify and I'll listen to Miley Cyrus's Spotify list, when it gets to Hannah Montana songs, I skip them because I just feel dirty.
But it's not Miley. It's Hannah Montana. It's a different person.
Party in the USA. Come on.
That's Miley.
That's Hannah Montana, isn't it?
No, it's
no,
not.
No, that's Miley. Yeah.
That's what she was
What's
doing.
What's Hannah Montana sings? The theme song of that show is like Best of Both Worlds, right?
Hannah Montana is like...
I have no idea for real. I'm the only girl at this table, and I have no idea.
Hannah Montana is like the seven...
for him to reveal his
Hannah Montana is like the seven things I hate about you. That's Hannah Montana.
Oh, okay. Cool, cool, cool.
Hannah Montana. What about Lizzie McGuire? You don't even have a little girl to blame this on. Like, for real. Like, if you had a little girl, I would be like, oh... Well, you watched it with her. Okay, I get it. Like, if Jason were to tell me he knew all the Hannah Montana stuff,
I'd be
totally
like
fine
Hannah
with that.
Is she?
It was the Disney.
Want to talk about some
iCarly
there, Blake? Or?
Are we done with the
the Disney afternoon hour?
Hold on, let me write down Miley Cyrus just so we can hashtag her.
So, like Paramount Plus, you guys heard of that streaming service?
Oh, yeah,
right?
Yes. We use it.
Mm-hmm.
So,
that's where you can watch Challenge All Stars.
Well, iCarly, which we do, came back. You guys, I'm sure you guys know that, right?
I know it. I don't watch it.
So my daughter used to watch iCarly when she was little, and now she's like 15. And so we watched like one or two episodes of the new version of iCarly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
isn't that scandalous?
Well, it's full on. Like, I mean, it's not like a lot of dirty words, but it's like it hints at like I've slept with people, and it's like
it's more teen.
Sure. Like, yeah. It's
like Riverdale? What? Riverdale is like,
my daughter's into Riverdale, too.
So nothing's like Riverdale.
Scandalous.
Nothing's like serial killers and fucking weird shit like Riverdale.
And teenagers just having sex all the time.
I was watching Riverdale for a few seasons, and then all of a sudden, Luke Perry stopped showing up.
No.
And I was like, why the fuck did you write Luke Perry out of the show? He's an American classic.
He gone.
What?
No.
His son's a wrestler.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Interesting.
It's adorable.
Facts. Do we do interesting facts already? I feel like we did it.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome.
We're doing it again. All right.
Oh. No, we didn't do it, did we?
We did do it.
We did do it.
Okay, well then move along then.
All right. Again, these are interesting facts provided by Chris Tuckley. Is he a Brit? Is that or Englishman? How would you describe him?
He's a good guy.
He's a good guy.
He's a proper good guy.
Last week we did the couch pilots.
Hashtag good guy.
Couch pilots.
Good guy dolls. No.
Guess what? I think good guy is going to be in next year's Chris Tuckley Christmas thing. Good guy.
Chris is good to you, I tell you why.
He is very good to me.
Because like there's a striking lack of Blake has crippling addictions in his holiday wishes us. He can fully take advantage of that. He does not.
Right.
Interesting facts. Modern Men was written by Peep Show writers Sam Bain and Jesse Armstrong, who were also responsible for writing One Free Hand, reviewed in Couch Pilots Season 25, Episode 6. Fact.
Wow, that's...
Do you remember that show?
No.
One Free Hand was a British one.
Yeah.
And it was done by, I think the lady's name was Nina Conti, and she was an English comedian who specialized in a monkey puppet.
Oh, yeah. Okay, now I remember. One Free Hand. Yeah, I was thinking of something completely.
It's probably something about jacking off.
Drinking a beer with his one free hand.
Jack off. French, right?
Yeah.
Although it starred a trio of established comedy actors in the title role, including Reese Shearsmith, fresh from the hugely successful sitcom The League of Gentlemen, the pilot was never transmitted. Fact.
Figgity fact.
Can't argue with the facts. Right? A year later, a sitcom pilot from the same team, including some of the same cast, called Ladies and Gentlemen, was transmitted as part of Channel 4's Comedy Playhouse season. It starred Couch Pilot's favorite and star of MeBox, Adam Buxton.
Ugh.
Buxton blogged at the time that this project also had the working title of Modern Men, but had to be changed because there was an American sitcom of the same name. Fact.
With that fact, I am now doing a debunk. MeBox. Hey. No, I'm doing it. I did not know that before this. I'm doing a MeBox debunk.
Not to reference it again, but last week in the Couch Pilots Carol, MeBox was referenced, and that was, I think, an original Tuckley 10 in a very bad pilot.
It was bad. It was very bad.
So, but I think Chris has a reverence for it because he said it deserves a second look. I will say it does not deserve that.
No. We will not do that.
A representative from the company that produced this pilot, Talkback TV Productions, said, The pilot is about the fact that men worry about the same things no matter what era they are from. These characters are Victorian, but their concerns seem very contemporary. Fact.
That makes a difference in my score.
And finally, another quote from that very same article that the last fact was pulled from that says, "With a team like this, this show simply cannot fail. Everyone's very excited." Ooh. A very ironic fact. End of interesting facts. Twitter responses.
Twitter responses. I'm hoping Jason got some Twitter responses.
No Twitter responses this week. But you guys see now? This is the second week here. You see how I can rely on him to do that?
Listen still? How flawlessly he does that. It sounds better than anything he said for the last half hour.
If you pay attention, you'll see that Blake closes
somebody
his
says
eyes.
Twitter responses. I'm like, whoa, boom.
Yeah. I got it. And it's clear
hey,
and
Blake,
it's good.
Twitter responses.
Twitter responses. Twitter responses. I wonder if Jason got some Twitter responses.
I bet Miley Cyrus loads that up and listens to you.
I bet she does.
You know what? I hope she does. There's some other things I can record for.
When you say that,
Gooder, was that just?
I've been all around.
No, it's Miley Cyrus.
It's her biggest hit.
Yeah, you never heard that song?
No.
It's a great. Oh, great Cyrus production. What's that? Let's take 10 minutes and break down the pilot of Modern Man.
Only 10 minutes, right?
Oh, I've already logged it into the computer, and it's begun the countdown. Blake, please start us off.
We got a jazzy music intro, and we had a little faster than that. And the title screen does not match what we see after that, which is... colonial times, right? Would you say
the title screen is very like cool, like, sleek,
and like
Grace.
Mad Men.
Yes, Will
like
and Grace.
Mad Men.
Mad Men.
I don't know Will and Grace, but I would agree, and I haven't seen Mad Men, but I agree with Mad Men because it's more of a mid-century kind of thing, and that's kind of the tone of the
high five that shit.
High five that shit.
We're in colonial times, I guess. In England, I think it's always been colonial times. Like, the whole time.
You assume this is a present day for England?
Yeah, I was like, oh, this, Chris Tuckley wears a big hat and a big coat and has a cane.
There's a horse and buggy. You see a cobblestone street, some brownstones. It's very clearly they're setting the establishing shot as a Victorian era England.
Right, mm-hmm. And we go into this very very small room, and there's three guys, and I think John is the first one we meet.
I think so. There's three guys. Two of the white guys to me look very similar, and I had a tough time
apart. John and Freddie.
Later, yeah.
John,
me too.
John and Freddie were that's hard. Right. Horatio Sanchez. We is very
he totally
easy.
Looked like Horatio. Yeah. Didn't
Oh, he was so Horatio. I was like quit eating that guacamole during the episode.
Well, one of them was trying to like write a song for a lady.
John.
And they sit down, and then they start talking about a guy. He's worried that he snubbed someone for the way that he gave him snuff. And I think we're like 90 seconds into this, mm-hmm. and I instantly think with this conversation, this is Seinfeld.
Yeah.
This is Curb Your Enthusiasm. Or these guys are having
This is men's version, Victorian England's men's version of Sex in the City.
How about Three and a Half Men?
I think it's Sex in the City.
I think it's totally Seinfeld because it's the minutia of everyday etiquette.
Yeah.
Is what it is.
Right. And the absurdity of like the extremes. Like,
yeah.
Right?
Yes. She pointed out it was like Sex in the City because they'd go off. Have their interactions with women or whatever.
And then they'd come back.
And then they'd come back to the pub and be drinking and talking.
And talking about it. It was very...
Not unlike Seinfeld meeting back at Monk's Diner.
Yeah,
it's true.
Sure. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
So the point in question was, he's snubbing someone. He gave him some snuff, and I think he gave it to him sitting down. He felt like...
Sitting down. That was the big... Yes.
Yeah, the big
you, go, you did it sitting down?
Is that like giving him a cigarette or like chew?
Snuff is tobacco, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it's you gave it to a guy named Jorgensen, and he'll come up quite a bit throughout the show. Then the conversation moves to voting, and they kind of laugh about women voting. And then the woman who's like a housemaid, her name's Emily, we find out. And she says something about keeping Jews out. And everyone's on the same page.
Yeah,
they're like,
right?
We should be doing that.
Well, because she's like, okay, these guys own me. I know what they like. I'm going to say something about the Jews so they're happy. But yeah, one of my questions right off the bat was, why is this a like a period piece? And it's strictly for this joke and a joke that happens later, like about women and women voting.
Oh, so you, right? You think that the only reason that's set in Victoria?
I really do. I really do. Like okay. The guy who wrote this was like, I love these jokes.
I love degrading women.
Yes.
I love poking fun. I think all these things. But
when is it appropriate? Oh, in colonial times.
There are a few things like the women voting in the Jews thing.
Victorian.
You know what?
The colonies say, over there.
You say colonial, I say Victorian.
It is different.
Pull the whole thing off.
There are things that are like era sensitive. But I think something that you said during Interesting Facts, Blake, was like you were willing to give this a bump because it talks to like the fact that people, no matter what the time, have the same insecurities and have the same things that they discuss. Yeah. Whether or not that's actually true from the time, they're showing us that it is quote-unquote true, right?
Yeah.
Sure.
Anyway, next you have a couple walking in the park. They're touching foliage. And I'm
believe it's John and Emily.
Was it Emily? I don't know if it was Emily the housemaid.
No, it's not Emily. No.
It had to be like
John and Sarah.
Maybe Mrs. Mansfield. I don't think it was Sarah. I don't think it was Sarah either. Sarah was almost exclusively with Horatio in that bedroom talking serious shit.
Right. Uh-huh.
This might have.
Okay. My bad.
But it's so early in the episode that we don't know.
We don't know who it is. We don't know who.
There's
it
a
is.
Lot. There's no like. Let's glide into this. It's like bang. Here you are. These are people. Right. Figure it out yourself.
We mentioned Sex in the City in the bar, and I think Brian agreed with me on Monks with Seinfeld. Here we go to the Jerusalem Tavern, which I think would be their normal. And do you remember what they're talking about here? This is Horatio and John.
What the fuck are they talking about?
Right. This isn't later.
Mollywop? I wrote Mollywop.
John is like, I don't know what to do with this Mansfield broad. And Horatio's
because she put her hand on his crotch or whatever.
And Horatio's like,
oh, yeah.
If you just like do
whatever
you want to do to a lady,
and just don't act like
you're
doing it,
and just don't act like you're doing it, don't say anything.
They'll let you do it.
My plan for life, and I've had three wives, and everything's been fine.
Horatio says you can get away with anything.
Then he demonstrates it by grabbing the waitress's
groping
boob.
Grab the waitress's
he like boob. Requests something, and while she's getting it, he just like honks her boob, and she does. It's like it doesn't even happen.
She doesn't flinch.
Nope.
Anyway, John.
I like a woman that doesn't flinch.
John is impressed by that, though.
Why wouldn't you be?
You're like, what? I can do this?
What?
And here we have the first of maybe two or three scenes where Horatio arrives to what we believe is his lady, is a lady named Sarah. She's in a big brass bed, right?
Yeah. His lady of the night.
You think she's
he is like she is his prostitute.
Oh, I didn't realize she was a prostitute. Okay.
Oh yeah.
Okay.
Well, he goes. I mean, why does he go? And it's always the bedroom, and she's. You
Maybe
know what
so,
I mean?
Right. And he's very.
It's not a house.
He's very eccentric, and she knows that. And she tells him that she was talking to one of her friends about him, and that makes him go over the fucking edge.
But it does feel like that he pays her.
Okay.
Oh,
it's kind of what it feels like.
I didn't get that, but that's interesting.
Hey, every time
point.
I have a sex with a woman, it feels like I'm paying.
Emotionally, you're paying every time.
And you know what? I'm paying them. Really.
Okay.
She drains that soul from him through his penis.
Well, you say that, but literally Horatio says, my cream stick needs a yank. This is something that he says. That.
And but by the way, that doesn't work if you do that in real life.
Yankee.
I watched the pilot, and that night I said that. My wife said, oh, fuck you.
Well, whether Sarah is his girlfriend or a prostitute, she doesn't like jokes. She's interested in the election. She's interested in real issues. She's a serious lady.
Which women shouldn't be.
And she just wants to talk about issues. She doesn't want to put up with any bullshit. But like, if he's paying her, she denies him sex, though, right? If you're a prostitute, you can't do that.
She doesn't really deny him. I think he goes to talk to her because I think that when you had these ladies on the side, they also were like their little confidants and stuff too. Okay. I think I don't think that it's I definitely got that vibe that she had to be.
Well, the three guys, John, Freddy, and Horatio, are back together again, and the conversation goes back to snubbing that Jorgensen.
Freddy is obsessed with the fact that he thinks this guy took his offering as a snub, mm-hmm. and this is throughout the rest of the episode. That's his thing. That's his bit.
He's trying to right this wrong.
Freddie has a bit. John has a bit. And Horatio has a bit, and that's what we're doing.
You're right. This is a total Seinfeld like thing.
This would be George Costanza too, yeah.
trying to like figure out how to rectify this. Yeah,
this is just the one-on-one human etiquette, human behavior that they're overanalyzing, and it's like, don't you have like the Black Plague to worry about? But no, they're worried about snubbing people with snuff.
With cheese or something.
And well, this time he's like, I offered him part of like a bun or a roll. Did I do it wrong? Is how I did it? Was it bad? So he felt like he snubbed him again when he was trying to right his wrong. Just these little pieces of etiquette that are overanalyzed.
And then we go back to Horatio, and he is back with Sarah. Mm-hmm. And she's sitting in her bed cleaning a gun. And that's when I was like, you know what? I love Sarah. I want to walk into a hot girl's bedroom.
Yeah.
She's laying on her big brass bed cleaning a gun.
Horatio seems to be like the most confident.
Isn't
of
she
the
supposed
bunch?
To be cleaning his gun?
No, just
high five that shit.
Just clean a gun.
Horatio, like, as confident as he seems, it seems to be like feigned confidence. As all the information and knowledge he gets comes from Sarah, whether or not he's the girl.
Yes.
Anyway, there's, let's see.
And I think that's part of the shtick of this show, too, is that they talk about how dumb women are and all this, but like the kind of leader of this guy group is basically getting all of
heavily
his
influenced by, yeah.
by a woman.
Sarah seems to easily be the most intelligent and knowledgeable of the bunch. Emily, who again, kind of, I don't, this room that they keep going back to, this small room where all three guys are, and Emily keeps coming in.
Yeah.
Do you think all three of these guys live together? Or is this one of the guys' house that they keep commuting at?
I think this is Jerry's apartment from Seinfeld.
Which one is Jerry?
Horatio,
probably.
So this is Jerry's house, you think?
Well, no, wait,
it can't be, because Emily's there, and she seems to serve, was it John?
Yeah.
So this might be John's house.
Because Horatio says, John, you need to fire her.
Yeah.
So it's got to be John. Because he's almost fired her, when he talks to her.
John's the one with the mustache.
Oh, sorry. The other one.
He's the one having the touching problems.
Oh, that's right.
Well, Horatio's back at Sarah, and
hashtag touching problems.
Right?
Horatio accuses Sarah about talking about him with Madeline. He does not like that, and he's very paranoid about what is being discussed about him. And she says, you know what, just as an example, something that we could talk about is like the weird shape of someone's head. He's like, my head? Is my head shaped weird? And for the rest of the episode, he is completely fixated on the shape of his head and what other people are saying about it.
Mm-hmm. And that reminds me of if a girl said something to you about how big your fucking head is,
right?
You'd be obsessed
about
it.
Just as an example. You're not saying that for me specifically.
No, I'm just saying,
just an example.
As an example,
right.
A guy with a huge fucking head.
I think we can look around the room and see everyone here has normal size.
Not as big
heads.
A head as you.
Right, just an example, though. It's like all of us have similar size head, but if you're to pick something out. It's
right. I mean, just randomly, your big ass fucking head.
Sure, yeah. This is it's not true to life. It's just an example.
No, I mean, this is an example of how big your fucking head is.
Yeah. No, I get that. Freddie continues to be.
Hugest forehead you've ever seen.
It's a six
Amanda,
and a half.
Amanda, look
head.
At that forehead. Seriously, you know. With,
listen, my.
You know what my doctor said?
Ryan's got a forehead. What are you.
My doctor said my hairline isn't moving. He said my eyes are migrating south.
Right. The Oregon Trail was originally mapped out on his forehead.
You got the Peyton Manning syndrome, where your hairline doesn't move, but somehow his head just
Omaha!
Gets taller. And
Omaha!
I'm going to let you do that to me.
I was just adding on to what you were saying.
You're the guest. I'll let you do that.
God damn it.
Tim, let's have Tim back here and Billy.
Right, hey, Blake drinks too much, right?
Hey!
No, this is a tough subject because seriously, look at Blake. He's like twice as old as all of
us
put together.
Yeah, he's got the best head of hair.
His hairline is steadfast, and I never use the phrase steadfast.
Right? It is.
You often say Tedfast. Right. But I never say
he's got that. He's got those good genes. Those good hair genes.
Believe me, my genes are not good.
Everything else is rotten to the core. But
yes,
that
hair gene. Yeah, it's good.
Thank you.
His hairline is the wall Trump envisioned of the southern border.
what we're gonna do here, we're gonna have a great hairline.
I love your
best.
your Jay Leno impression is the best. Let's hear some more of it.
No.
Somehow his Trump impression turns into like a racist Japanese impression. I don't know how you do it.
I'm just trying to hold the show up. And say,
you're doing a great job.
Great job.
So Freddie is totally fixated on the snub. He's like, I sent a letter now to Jorgensen. I feel so bad. But I don't think it got there because Emily screwed it up. So Horatio's like, you got to fire that broad.
Yeah.
I think you mentioned that earlier, right, Amanda?
Yes.
So Freddie confronts Emily in her very, very small closet. Oh, my goodness.
Very small.
Poor Emily.
Closet, right?
Okay, let's get this out of the way. Emily's kind of a babe, right?
Oh, yes. Yeah, smoke show for sure.
Holy cow.
She's right?
She's also a modern. She's also smart. You know what I mean? Like,
oh, I don't God. Know. Is she smart?
You know what?
I think she Forget threw that. It. I think she's playing these boys, don't you?
I think part of the reason I'm so attracted to Emily is because how dumb she is.
She's dumb? You think she's really dumb or you think she's playing dumb?
I think that Brian would not pick her out of the strip club. He didn't seem impressed.
I'm just saying. You see my wife.
I mean, all right. Fair enough.
He likes the smart wife. He likes the smart ladies.
So Freddie is
Jesus.
Like, that's every episode, guys. Freddie is super timid in trying to reprimand Emily. She's very, I think she's kind of dim, but she's correct that she thinks that she's going to be fired. So when she goes to leave, like, he begs her to stay. So my question is, do you guys think that he is secretly in love with this lady?
I think that he just can't be, like,
assertive.
A jerk. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, he's not assertive.
He doesn't want to hurt her feelings. And I think he's the type that if he were to make a lady cry, he just couldn't deal. He'd be like, oh my God, she's crying, and just run away.
Not secretly in love with her.
I don't think so.
Am I secretly in love with her?
I don't think you're not secretly. I think, yeah.
It's pretty that's obvious.
Right? Well, I'm putting that in my memory bank. So if I find this girl out there, Jason, I'm going to bring
you
her to
you. Can find her
in
13 minutes on a dating app. You can find her for 30 for sure.
I like dumb broads and rags.
That's right?
You want dumb broads what?
In rags.
In rags.
And that are alive.
I was going to say, let's look her up on IMDb, see if she's
Her name is
stolen.
Kara Horgan, and if you put the word nude after that, you can find pictures of her.
Nice!
Don't ask me how I know. The next scene, you're in a...
Man, you guys is so intriguing to me. Like, I don't ever, like, watch something and go like, God, that guy's attractive. Let me go.
Because dicks
Let
are
Let me
ugly.
Go.
Dicks are gross.
Yeah, dicks are gross.
But I don't even do, like, shirtless. You know what I mean? It's not even the same. You know, because, like, I mean, really, guys shirtless is pretty... Like, the girls kind of...
Let me shatter your world. We're fucking disgusting. Guys are gross.
We're gross. Okay? Let me posit you guys a question, because she answers no every time I brought this up.
Bring it on.
If there's somebody that you know and you found out there's a video online of them having sex, would you watch it?
Yes.
I'm doing it before you finish the sex.
Yes, exactly. No. And I've told her this, and she's like, no, I would never want to see a video of someone I know having sex. I'm like,
I can't
you're
get rid
lying.
Of the mental image.
Even
like,
if it said
I would look at you, and I would always think of it. Like,
no, if
it
said Jason Tosher having sex, I would still click on it. Yeah.
If Brian is telling me that sentence, I am guessing what the rest of the sentence is.
Right.
Googling
I've
it
already
before
Googled
he
it before he finishes
before
the sentence.
Before he finishes yes. it. So-and-so, there's a video. Oh, my
And he's right, I think.
Because I think she was acting like I was insane, and I'm like, no.
No, she doesn't. Because a lot of times, like, sometimes ladies
girls
like,
don't do that.
Sometimes, like, hey, we're pretty sick too. It's like, no, we are fucked. We are fucked up, and we will do the worst things. You think of a worst thing, you multiply it, you put the two at the end, you square
and
it.
That's why men can't, like, it's you is the reason
Point
that I can't hang out with guys
that's
by
exactly.
myself.
For sure.
It's not
like
me.
Right.
It's all of you.
As soon as Brian goes upstairs, I'm going to try to fuck your brains out.
So this is the way I look at it. If you go to my ex-hamster account, this is recommended, and you see what's on it, and you go to Amanda's ex-hamster recommended,
you created,
not the same.
You created an account.
Yeah. No, I'm just saying, like, yeah, there's
no, you're
big
right.
difference.
You're totally right.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Oh, my God.
The next scene, we got Freddie in a room. He's dressed well, and there's two nice dressed ladies in there. Is this John or Freddie? I can't keep in track.
It's Freddie.
It is
and
John.
It's Emily. It's Emily.
Mm. Emily's the servant, but she's not one of the ladies in the room. One of the ladies in the room, I believe, is the Mansfield lady. And there's a guy groaning, And he says, "Is that your father upstairs dying?" Yeah. And she says, "Yes,
yes, it is.
It's referenced before that. Like he's like, "Hey, I've been seeing this girl. Her dad is in the process of dying."
Oh, I didn't catch that.
I missed that.
But here we are experiencing that.
Yeah.
And John and the girl are talking, and he tries to do the moves like Horatio taught him about.
Right? Yes, yeah. Yes.
How does that turn out? Do you remember that?
She just kind of just goes with it and keeps talking, and he's
where is his hand?
Molesting her face and then sticks his fingers in her mouth.
Yes, yeah.
And she likes it. She does like it.
Well, she does. Yeah,
it,
you're right.
Well, Horatio is right.
Yes,
like,
he
can do these things, and the ladies don't
just
say anything.
Act like you don't. Act like you're not doing something, and just keep doing it.
Because it's not proper to bring it up.
That's probably the case. They're back at the tavern.
I wish I was in the olden days.
All three of the guys there at the tavern, and Freddie finally gets a letter.
Obviously.
Freddie gets a letter from Jorgens, the guy he feels like he keeps snubbing, and it tells him nothing, but it confirms that he received his letter. And then it includes a small piece of cheese, and he says this in itself may be a snub. So Freddie thinks he's like, you know what?
So small.
Is this George Costanza right here?
I think
totally.
So.
It's just George Costanza for sure.
Totally. Yeah, I think he says, you know, I've
overanalyzing.
I think I found a way to write this wrong. I'll send him back the cheese, and if he's offended, then I'll know that it wasn't meant as a snub. And if he is offended, then double fuck this guy because he was trying to offend me.
Yeah. He'll say that he doesn't like cheese. That's what he's going to do. He's like, well, I don't really like cheese, so I'm going to return it and say, I don't like cheese.
It's insane, though, right? Like, his level of thinking about this is crazy.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Well, the jerk store ran out of you.
That's a sign for
that. Obviously, that's why I did wrong.
Well,
I don't know any quotes.
high five that shit.
Are you eating that Snickers with a fork and a knife? How do you eat it? With your hands?
Oh, Jesus.
So indignant about it. Yeah.
Hey, Amanda, how's it going?
Bullshit. Whatever.
I'm used to it. It doesn't bother me. No. I just smile.
Oh, yeah.
So
I've done that for 7 years with Jason. Just smiled.
Never know what he's talking about. Yeah. Just smile. Uh-huh.
John's back in the park, and he sees that Mansfield lady that he's interested in, and he calls her by name, and then he sees that she's with a soldier. And then he pretends like he's talking to someone else. You remember
some
that?
Yes.
Some old guy.
Yeah.
But he calls her. Her name is Jennifer, right?
Yeah, Jennifer. Well, because the girl's name's Jennifer. Yeah, and he's hollering out at her. And people notice that he's hollering at her. And he's like, oh, no, I'm not talking to her. I'm talking to this other person named Jennifer.
This gentleman walking
down
the
bushes. Old gentleman.
This person is an old guy,
Yeah.
And then there's a very awkward handshake between the two.
Which I love. We didn't talk about it, but the first scene where they're walking through the park, I love that he's just randomly talking about how boring it is. Like, you go to the park, what the fuck are they doing? They're just walking around through the park.
And doesn't she, like, start touching a bush and...
Yeah, touching the foliage. Yeah,
and then she touches his foliage. Well,
yep.
Yeah.
It is funny because, like, today we would think, that's kind of boring. But back then, they wouldn't know better. They wouldn't know whether or not what they're doing is
Nintendo Switch. There's no Nintendo Switch.
They had no Nintendos back then. Can you imagine that?
Why not just kill yourself?
They'd write letters and shit.
With, like, ink and, like, a horse's tail hair?
Like a quill.
Oh, that's what I was going to say.
Yeah, feather.
So they go back to the house, which I believe was John's house, and the three fellas, John doesn't understand why the girl that he groped doesn't now like belong to him because he saw her out with a soldier.
Mm-hmm.
And then Horatio approaches Emily at the house, and apparently they have a sexual past together. And he says, hey, what? Go back in the other room. Pretend you're cleaning. And listen to those guys and see if they're talking about my weird-shaped head. And she comes back in, and they weren't.
Yeah. She's like, okay.
They're not talking about you.
She was like...
Horatio then bursts in the room and confronts John and Freddie about his head, and they are very confused, as it is clear they have never given it a second thought.
Yeah. And the next scene is John and Jennifer in a canoe, if I'm not mistaken. Mm-hmm. And there's a lot more groping and touching, but then when he points it out, that's when she's like, no. That's not what's going on.
Totally turned off by it.
Do not mention it.
Yeah.
Just grope. Do not ask. Guys, listen. If you're with a girl, if you want to grope them, do not ask them. Do not mention it. And just grope them
until they say... You don't think that this is basically just her retaliation or back.
No,
like,
to me,
and like, no, you didn't. I couldn't talk about it when you did it.
No, now, to me, this is she's being a whore, and she knows the captain's gone. She's rubbing up all, and she's like, yeah. "Hey, let's Basically, this is the first ever account of blue balls in
recorded history.
I was gonna say
colonial times.
Colonial times.
You know what? My show. Go ahead and take it.
They're back at the tavern, and John confides in Horatio about Mansfield, and they're in the bar, and they look across, and they see the soldier. Apparently, his name is Wilkins, and they're talking to the guy that was doing the snubbing earlier. Wilkins, his name is Jorgens.
Yeah, Jorgens. Jorgens.
Jorgens the Wilkins.
And John and Freddie are like very fixated on the conversation between those guys from afar, and John says they're talking about head size, and Horatio is outraged.
Shit. And the only thing that like prompts them to think that he's talking about
is some hand gestures.
Is he just lifts his hand like about 3 inches over his head.
They begin their conversation about Wilkins and Jorgens. They start like spreading rumors about them as like their own personal form of revenge against.
Right,
them.
They're like,
yes,
oh,
let's make up. Let's talk about them. I know what we can do. We'll talk about them.
Yeah, they're talking about shit about us.
Yeah,
what's the best way to get back at them?
Yeah,
talk shit about them.
They're just making
and
up.
It's just the three of them in a little cul-de-sac of the pub.
They're making up all this stuff about those guys, and then Horatio gets enough gumption up to confront those two guys. And he basically unloads on them all the rumors that were seconds, not even minutes, made up about them.
Yes. And the guys don't understand it all. They're like,
they
what
have
are you
no
what
idea
doing?
What they're talking
what
about.
What in the world?
And then Horatio goes on to grope both of them. And
yes.
And then they're like completely like they have no idea what's happening.
Doesn't Horatio kiss one of them?
Yes.
Kisses one, grabs the other guy's cock and balls, and then Horatio goes back to his buddy, and John and Freddie are like completely amused and satisfied.
Oh, yeah. Yes, you did it. Way to go! Yeah.
And that's the end of that.
Yeah, thank God.
What a
please remain
classic
seated as
tour de force. Holy smokes! This is the part of the show where we say we just watched it. Why didn't it work? It only had one episode. Blake, you got any reasons why this show didn't work?
Well, I had a couple problems with it.
Yeah, take your time. One more. That'll do it.
Right. I don't understand a lot of British humor. I think there was a lot of
Hummer. I said a Hummer.
Hey, I've never had a British Hummer. I don't know. British humor. There's a lot of things that went over my head.
Mm-hmm.
I don't understand. Okay. And I did. There was no like intro to the characters. She's like, here's three guys in a room, and then you go with that.
Mm-hmm.
And so that bothered me too.
That bothered you, okay. Then, don't you? Okay. If you were to improve this, Amanda, what would you like to see done?
Probably have your dog stop barking when your wife's trying to sleep.
I just right.
Yeah.
I feel like in 2006 that. This wouldn't go over well with the female population.
But it's the BBC, which allows just about everything.
Well, and the BBC, I do feel like the BBC is a little more like of that gropey.
Risque.
Like, well, the gropey is, kind of like, I don't know. It's
a little more Benny Hill.
Yeah, exactly. Benny Hill. That's it. Benny Hill is kind of that gropey kind of
squeezing nurse tits.
Yeah, that I you
why
know
are
so
nurses. Why are you gonna be
like slapping that old guy into the forehead?
Yeah. Sure.
So maybe over there it would be acceptable, but I feel like this would not be popular amongst lady viewers.
Okay. Even in 2006.
Even in 2006.
If this kept going, what would we see, Brian?
Probably a lot more groping, a lot more joking about women doing common things.
Yeah.
Seemed
to be a demo.
Yeah.
Women doing common things.
I don't know if it's just like, I try not to be one of these like overly sensitive women, but it was like, maybe these guys were just extra douchey and it was just like real uncomfortable, listening to them say these things. And I think it's meant to feel that way because of the comedic effect.
Right.
I don't know.
It wasn't,
but maybe it's, maybe I'm just too much in 2021, you know?
Well, like, we went back to 2016.
I know, I try. I'm trying,
back.
Yes.
Amanda, you got to go back in your mind.
We've done everything we can do for you.
I know, yeah. I tried.
There wasn't even Band-Aids back then, and you're like, just fucking saying shit.
As I said earlier, it reminded me of like Curb Your Enthusiasm or Seinfeld. And I don't want to take a head of steam away from you at all, and I apologize in advance. Also kind of reminded me of another period, right? Did you ever watch that show?
No, yeah. Yeah, for sure. Very funny. You know I did, for sure.
But you did think of that while watching this.
Yeah.
Are you guys familiar with that show, Another Period? It's a Comedy Central show starring, I think, Ricky Lindholm and Natasha Leggero.
Yeah.
Oh, no.
Yeah. Michael Ian Black was in it.
It's set in Victoria. Was it England or was it America?
It was America.
But it was set like in the late 1700s, I think, right?
Actual colonial times?
For sure. But it included like a ton of like well-known like comedians and stuff, and it was just kind of they were doing, I think, something very similar here, where they were playing on the tropes of the time and the etiquette of how these people would behave, but doing kind of a modern bit of humor on it.
Yeah,
very similar. Sure. So you did think about that?
No, yeah, a little bit.
How did you think it fared against something like that? Because you did. You do like... I've never seen a full episode of Another Period, but I immediately thought
I watched the whole... I think there was two seasons. Okay. I enjoyed it because I knew what it was and what it was supposed to be. And it does remind me of that. I guess it was the American version of it. So it's just...
Maybe so, yeah.
Yeah.
All right, well...
Man.
That's...
Ladies and gentlemen, as we start our descent... You guys see a
water stain on the ceiling in the corner right there?
I think it's just where the plaster is different than the ceiling.
You don't see you don't see a ring.
No.
That's bothering me, yeah.
I'm not worried about it.
Is there water coming in? Do you think you're still getting water?
No, I do believe that I have used Drano too much in the tub to where it's eating.
Right.
And that's
probably what it
is. Right, you know what? Yeah. You know what, guys? Fuck me, right?
Yeah.
Fuck this house. Just bulldoze it.
I was like...
I can't wait.
Get water from the outside, getting water from the inside. Just all the water.
This is the part of the show where we say other people have seen Modern Men, not just us. However, there are no scores on Rotten Tomato, IMDb, and nothing I could find critic-wise either. But again, I did reach out to YouTube, rather, and I found comments there.
Okay.
Old Snake 22 says, "How on earth did this not get made into a series? Wonderfully funny."
Because I hate women too.
Marie Francis says, "Reese Bloody Shearsmith." We got a fan. Clam R, and oddly enough, this was just 5 days ago.
5 days.
Clam R said, "If anyone has a copy of Ladies and Gentlemen, could they send me? I'll send you $50 immediately."
Ladies and Gentlemen.
That was something mentioned in Interesting Things.
Mm-hmm.
How much is $50?
It's like $1 million.
Jesus.
It's like $100.
Gab,
I wish I would have known that for last week's pilot.
I think Brian tried to communicate that to you.
$100 times. Double. Didn't we say the double? Like, double.
But I thought he was lying to me.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Oh. That makes sense.
So it was $2,000 basically.
He won about $3,000.
Yeah. Because it was like what? Like 17?
16 something. Yeah, about 17.
Now, you look that up before?
No, I asked him and he knew.
I remember back in the day, I think it was someone.
On Fans Only made you convert it.
Yeah, and made me convert it.
And it has a lot to do with the strength of any currency at a given time, but roughly.
It could fluctuate, but.
Yeah, it's about 1.5 to 2 times the amount.
From what I remember, people had one time said like, "Oh, it's like double."
Okay.
Because we were looking at something, and I'm like, "I don't know how much that is." And they're "Oh, you kind of double it, and that's about what it is in dollars."
Hey, thanks for helping me last week.
I mentioned it, so wait, listen.
Maybe try it a little harder.
Mentioned it. I reinforced it. Maybe. Jason talked about it. I mean,
maybe flash a light in front of my eyes.
maybe scream at the drunk. I don't know. Gav Tattoo says chickens came along in 2011 and quacks in 2017. Somewhat similar feels to them. I don't know what that means.
That's just a bunch of gibberish. Is what that is.
I wrote that.
13 seconds ago, Captain Philip Ressischer says. No, Jack Straw says, "Turns out Emily was right after all." Whatever.
Dick.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to FCF Airport. Local time is 11:11, and the temperature is 69 degrees.
Nice. You ever hear that? 69. You ever hear that? You ever hear of 69 before?
No. What does it mean?
It's
the Yahtzee move.
Well, it's like when two people, it doesn't matter the gender.
It's a, yeah. It's Amanda, it's a Yahtzee move. Don't listen to him.
Blake describes it best.
It's when you put a bunch of dice into a little cup and you just shake the shit out
That's
of it.
That's what 69 is? Yeah. You are ill-informed.
It's never worked for me.
Good Lord.
Everybody's like, oh, it's great. I'm like, just loud.
The last time I had it was pretty good. Hear me now. Now it's time to...
You said the last time you had it was pretty good. Was it,
yeah, yeah.
In a twin bed? Yeah.
Had it. Not did it, had it. Like, it's a very interesting
That's
way
right.
to
I had it done to me.
I had... Like, it's a two-man operation.
I paid the amount.
Two men?
It was done to me.
Two men?
Yes. I paid two men to 69 me.
Isn't like a to be fair, that like 184? Isn't like 184?
To be fair to Blake, at the end he did yell Yahtzee. So
everyone wins. When I 69, everyone wins.
Oh my god.
Time to score, modern men. We do it on a scale. 1 to 7 is the grading scale based on the television show from the 1990s, affectionately and accurately known as Wings. We look at all the characters from that program. We assign them numbers. 1 is the worst score you can get. Oh my god, that's the character called Roy Biggins. Number 7, that's the best score you can get. That's a fellow goes by the name of Brian Hackett. Amanda, I turn towards you. How do you rate modern men?
Listen, I feel like if you just took out some of the overtly awful women references, this could be a really good show. Well, and I'd really...
I think that's the whole point of the show, though.
Like, if every episode is just, like, constantly that, I don't know if I would really
Do you think
really
they did the time
it.
Period so they can make those jokes? Like, there's three guys that have these jokes about women and, like, this dissing women. And like,
when would it be okay to say that?
That's right. I honestly felt like that.
It could be. Well, if they're not going to change that piece of the show, then I'll give this a solid 3. But okay. if we could just tone it down a little bit, I would give this show a 5.
Well, we can't though, so well, give it a 3.
5. Okay.
Because I think the whole point was to point out how ridiculous shit like that used to be.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, I think they were serious when they said
it. It's not really that ridiculous.
You'll have your piece. Brian, I turn to you. How do you rate modern men?
Can you do halves?
Sure.
No.
We frown on it, but you can
okay.
If you don't mind a scowl, you
3.75.
Oh, no.
Wow.
No, I'm just joking. 3 then.
Okay.
I feel like it's fine, but it's not something I would seek out to watch.
That
every
humor
week.
Isn't funny to me.
Okay.
Maybe that's really what I'm going to get at. Like, I like smart humor, and that humor is not funny.
It's easy. It's low-hanging fruit.
Yeah, it's just, like, two on the nose. It's like... Yeah.
And you like women, right? That's the other part.
I mean...
Like, no, you appreciate
them. I don't think it's funny when you're
if
like...
If you don't appreciate women, this is a higher score for sure.
Well, people would say, you like the Beatles or you like the Rolling Stones?
The Beatles,
you
make sure. Every day.
And then some people would be like, hey, you like Seinfeld or do you like the show called Friends? So I assume you'd be in the Friends camp then.
Yeah, I like a little more of the smart, dry humor.
Well, I don't
humor.
Know if I'd call it smart.
Sarcastic.
Sarcastic, yeah. Sarcastic, but yeah. Sarcastic or dry or something that is smart humor. I like those much more than I like. I think a lot of men like comedies that are kind of that like dick and fart jokes, you know, poop jokes.
Sure.
And those? I feel like this might be kind of that.
All okay. right. So what's the score then? You gave it a what?
3.
Two threes. Okay.
But I feel like you could, if you really wanted to like watch all that, you just watch Seinfeld. They do it way better.
Seinfeld.
Why do I need a period version?
Seinfeld had been off the air 8 years at that point.
Yeah, so. That's true.
Captain Philip Restisher, I turn to you. How do you rate modern men?
I got to give it a tuggy bump because it's the UK and I don't understand a lot of stuff. There were jokes that I thought, oh, if I was in the UK, it would be funnier. Mm. I'm sorry, Amanda. I like when...
I know you do. It's fine. I know it. I know guys like this humor.
I like when men degrade women every day.
I know men like this humor.
I'm going to give
it... my jam.
I'm going to give it a 3 as well. I got lost. I didn't appreciate
Give it
all
a
the
three as well.
Yeah, I didn't appreciate all the jokes too.
Well, not unlike the snub letter, the cheese shall stand alone. I'm sorry,
hey, guys.
Yeah, fuck your dogs. Look.
My wife's trying to make a point, so just pet the dog.
That's
no, we don't mind the dog.
That's reflection on you being able to wrangle your wife. This is a 6 for me.
Wow.
Woo!
This show was funny. These putting it in a period piece and still making it funny, it's not an easy task. There was a bit of a budget here, doing everything in a period manner.
Oh, you'd have to, yeah.
But it didn't look like it had a lot of budget. Like it felt like it was still like an indie kind of thing. It's so much so that it's not in IMDb. Now, I don't expect any of you guys to know that, but in my research, I could not find it there. And so that kind of speaks to the independence of the project that it didn't even make it there. There are different ways to approach making sitcoms. Larry David absolutely has his own formula. A guy like Dan Harmon, 100, like he's come out and said, this is how I create my sitcoms. And it's I love Dan Harmon's stuff.
Yeah.
This is taking a note from like Jerry Seinfeld and Larry David 100%. This is them trying to replicate Seinfeld in the UK in a period piece. It doesn't necessarily get points for its style and originality, but like in the period, they're doing something fun.
Yeah.
I like this. I thought this was pretty funny. I'm going to give this a 6. I really enjoyed it. If they made more, I would probably watch a few of these. I had a really good time with it. So I'll stand
alone.
Thank
you, misogynist.
Oh, I hate women. Thank you for pointing it out.
Well, it's obvious.
Your track record.
What? You're awful. 3 3s and my
some
6.
Some of them kill themselves. That's how bad.
I never dated her at all. Awful thing to say. And with that, we close the book on Modern Men, and we shall never speak of that pilot again.
Ever.
But join us next time, won't you please, when we watch the pilot episode, watch Blake furiously write down the 4 letters in the word cows. Here's a little something to wet your whistle. When a family of anthropomorphic cows is introduced to their son's new human girlfriend, the differences in their lifestyle become more apparent. And when their house is destroyed, they must find a new place to live. You can find the entire episode of Cows by subscribing to Couch Pilots on SoundCloud, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, or your favorite podcast app of choice, and then simply click in one of our classically blue links in our show notes, or go to YouTube. Brian?
Do too.
Do too, do.
Hey, you remember this, Blake? You remember this?
Yeah.
What is this?
Dog Police.
This show, from what I've seen already, is kind of like that.
A little bit.
These are human beings dressed up like cows.
Really?
I'm not fucking with you.
Oh, jeez.
Is this like dinosaurs, but with cows?
Yeah.
But probably worse. Like, I don't think the Jim Henson Company was involved.
No, okay.
Yeah.
You're going to want the Jim Henson Company, right?
Oh, exactly. if you're doing any kind of puppets or...
You know why this dog is down here right now?
Because your wife's tired of it barking?
It's because for the past 45 minutes, this dog's been barking the whole time.
Yeah, you really got to get control. Like, you're the man of the house. You got to get control of these dogs. You got to get control of that wife.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
Blake, you need to fire her.
She's letting the dog come into the studio.
Right, yeah.
You got to get control of this wife, man.
I've never had control of my wife, so.
Yeah, if you come over to the podcast studio, no dogs over there.
Yeah,
that's a great point.
You know what? My wife will probably like donate money
my wife.
To your Patreon just so
you would go somewhere else.
Blake, if they wanted to kiss a dog or find out where to watch or get a hold of us, what would they do?
I don't know. I'm petting my dog right now.
We'll just skip that shit. You plugged some of that stuff last week, but anything else you want to plug it again? By all means.
Yeah. Right. Go check out Brian and I on Challenged, a podcast all about MTV's The Challenge. Every week we sit down and right after the episode and we review the episode in its entirety and talk about all the challenges and the craziness that ensues. And weird things like where we like to eat and
come over and leave reviews talking about Amanda's laugh because we've been getting lots of those lately.
Oh, I love it.
Positive reviews?
Yeah.
Both.
I give it a 7 out of 7.
Some
pretty,
people
pretty good laugh.
Yeah.
Some people like to come on, like to, because we get on rants and Tim was talking about his Ben Franklin hair that he had in high school.
I lost it.
She couldn't stop laughing.
Now, every time I see Tim, he's wearing a hat. Yeah. Sometimes it says the word penis on it. Sometimes it's got an
avocado. Yeah.
But always he's bald underneath it. Was he balding in high school enough to where he could do a Ben Franklin?
Well, it wasn't a skullet. No. It was just very long and it parted it down the middle.
Yes.
But he looked like Ben Franklin.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And so we talked about that. And then some people leave reviews like, don't talk about your lives. We don't know you. We don't care about your inside jokes. And the girl laughing like a donkey for 5 minutes wasn't funny.
You know what? I would say, fuck you.
That's what a lot of people said and left positive reviews saying, we love Amanda's laugh. Fuck that guy.
I was going to say, you listen to a podcast because you want what the content is, but you stay for the host.
Exactly. Yeah.
For the people who are like shitting on you guys, what do they want? It's like, if you just want what's on the show, then why don't you just watch the fucking show and come to your own conclusions, right?
Exactly.
I want the name of that person. I'm going to find him.
We're going to fucking ruin his life.
Fuck it.
We know a guy in the UK and a girl in Australia.
Whatever that's worth,
Mm-hmm. We're talking about doing a fast, because we were talking about the best fast food burgers on one episode.
Oh, yeah.
Talking about doing a blindfolded fast food burger challenge.
If you had to,
I want to do it.
Oh, yeah.
What do you guys think off the top of your head? Who's got the best burger?
Oh, who has Whopper? The best burger?
As
far as fast food goes.
With cheese, right?
Of course.
I'd go Wendy's.
I love a Whopper with cheese, but I also like, I think Hardee's does a really good job with burgers.
Yeah.
I don't like the meat since they went to Carl's Jr. and then
well, they've always been Carl's Jr.
Well, in Central Illinois, they changed the meat, and I don't like the meat.
Did they change
now,
it?
Okay. Yeah, it's weird. I think the best hamburger meat at a fast food restaurant is Wendy's.
This is what I'll say about Wendy's. When you go and you get a burger from them,
it tastes like a burger.
Burger's hot. The lettuce, tomato, and onion, cold. I like that.
Yeah.
I like that.
Yeah, crisp.
Old McDLT?
Yes. You got to have that crisp. And that's the other thing about Wendy's is you get all those like fresh, good toppings.
Ooh, yeah.
Their bacon is also nice and thick.
Yeah.
The other restaurants, it's like that real thin bacon.
Wendy's has got the Baconator, right?
The best sandwich on the menu.
For $12, it's great.
You don't have a sandwich called Baconator and not have good bacon.
That's it, right? Dude. Their Baconator is my favorite sandwich.
What's the last time you had a Baconator, Blakenator?
About maybe 3 weeks ago.
Hell yeah.
Yeah.
Hell yeah.
That's probably about the same. When we had Wendy's last was about
can I do that challenge when you guys do it? Can I
for real. Yeah.
Can I drive him there because he'll be drunk?
Yes, he'll need a driver.
I'll drive you there. I'm doing you a solid.
I don't go places drunk.
Go back to your house drunk. So
you went to
you
the Moose.
Going
hold up, hold up. You were at the Moose drinking and you got drunk and then you came home.
No,
so you
I
did
didn't
go
get
places.
Drunk there. I just picked up a contract
and drank your Jack and Cokes.
Just one.
Well, that sounds like a That sounds like a fun thing you're doing on challenge. But I mean, is it things like that that keeps you still invested in the show, or do you still like watching the?
Oh yeah, we like the show.
Yeah, we still enjoy the show. We still have a good time doing it.
What's the guy's?
Yeah, we mainly talk about the show. The interludes are. Yeah.
CT, yeah.
Is he still around?
Yeah.
Now he's on the season, but he's going to be in a movie with Tom Berenger soon.
And he just got his AARP card, is that right?
I think he's in his 40s.
I think he's not that old.
Is he really?
I think he might be, what is he, 44?
Something like that.
Somebody really?
Said? Yeah.
I think somebody said he was 44.
Look, I'm 40 now myself, but when I think about MTV and reality shows, I don't think about a fucking 44-year-old guy.
I saw a TikTok the other day of the original cast from Real
Maybe
World
42
Real okay. World they showed a picture of them then and
yeah
then now I'm I am old I am fucking
Paramount
old.
Plus they did a new version of the Real World where they brought all the people from the very first season back.
They're doing it
again,
Los Angeles
and there's more on the docket already
in Los Angeles
because we just need to recycle not make anything original
you know what happens is the people who loved this stuff when they were young are now older and they want more of
this
content and they're catering to themselves.
Yeah.
And that's what it is. It's like we have just finally gotten old enough that our people are now making stuff that
some
we want to see.
Some poor son of a bitch out there is like, well, I wonder what Pedro's up to. Turns out he's been dead for 25 years.
He's dead as your last girlfriend.
That season, I cried. Oh, man.
What, when Pedro died? Or
yeah. When Puck spit
on... He didn't die during the season, right? He died
no,
after the
but
season.
They no, did, like, a reunion. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's when I was upset. It was when Puck spit on that.
When Puck bought all the peanut butter?
He spit on Pedro.
Yeah,
he's just I was like, oh, Puck. Man.
Good Lord.
He's going to be misunderstood.
All right, Blake, we're winding down here. Tell me some facts about R-O-C-K in the U.K.
Yeah, R.I.P. Queen Elizabeth II. Couple facts about this young lady. She hosts an average of 50,000 people every year at receptions, banquets, luncheons, and dinners, and garden parties at Buckingham Palace.
Only 50,000?
50,000 a year.
That
That's
doesn't
amazing.
Seem like enough.
It does it? If you think about it. How many months are in the year? Exactly.
It doesn't feel like it. I feel like some of these big dignitary parties are like 5,000 people in a party. So, okay. I mean, that's only 10 parties in a year.
So Amanda, Amanda, I love your spirit, but I spent a lot of time searching for these facts.
Shut up, Amanda.
Although her birthday is April 21st, it's celebrated in June.
Why is that?
It's better for the calendar, I guess.
Those are two great facts. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Royals are weird.
That's probably all the facts you got, though.
I got one more fact. Huh? I got one more fact if you want it. I mean,
oh, yeah,
we,
yeah.
We've been on this show for a long time. But
give us all you got.
Okay, in November. Did I just say
November? You sure did.
I was trying to say it like a. In November of 2019, Prince Andrew does a BBC interview, later known as the car crash interview. In this interview, he was quoted as saying that he was never truly close to Mr. Epstein. He also said he could not recollect Virginia Gulfer and that the picture of them both was doctored.
It's almost like you're reading that for the first time. I feel like every time you do this, there's a...
I feel like, yeah, you're right. Yeah. Queen Elizabeth had a lot of respect for
very
her.
Very interesting woman.
Yes, very interesting. I got more facts about her coming up.
Tune in next week.
Yeah. And I got some facts about the other guy.
Yeah. Brian Prince Andrew. And Amanda. I'm sorry.
All right.
Sorry for what happened here today.
No, you're fine.
What happened?
It's 50% me.
And 50% me.
Right. We Blake and I are adult enough to take responsibility for things that happen.
Yeah.
We are glad that you're here.
Oh man, no, we had a blast, you guys. No, this is always a fun time.
No, we're always glad you guys.
That's why we always say yes.
This would be my my challenge. Which they watch the challenge. Right? Ooh, this would be my challenge each of you. This episode comes out on December 27th.
Okay.
Listen to the show after this, and you will hear how not excited Blake is. And you will see that both of you bring out the best in him every time.
I'm not excited.
But because they bring out the best in you.
Well, they
because you're the best around. See,
Jason can say this because he knows in his head that Amanda's never gonna listen. So you guys can all tell me that whatever, and I'll just go, okay.
I could bring 100%. I could bring 100% Blake. It's not even half of 100% Amanda. I'm letting her have it. Just let her have it.
I'm not slamming you. I'm just saying.
Oh, I thought you were making it sound like I didn't do a damn thing in this episode. I basically carried this episode.
How many times over the past couple weeks have I said these two guests bring out the best in you and make you feel? That's what I'm saying.
I love both of them very much. Jesus, I do enjoy them. I want to get back to dinners. Yes. You know, the world's open. There's no more COVID. COVID's over.
We beat it, guys. We beat it.
Tim's got some free time coming up. He wants us to
all get
together.
Can we do that? Can we set that up?
I'd love to. All
right. Yes. Can we not go the Hofbräu?
There's no Hofbräu to go to.
Thank you. Okay.
We'll find some other ethnic food for you to eat, though. Let's go to the Indian restaurant.
No, I will not go. I will say no.
Yes, you will go.
I will say no to all of you.
You will go.
I will eat crackers.
You will eat curry, and you will shit your pants. You will do it.
I will not do it. If you guys want to see me, it's got to be some kind of meat or a potato.
I was going to say, but do you do like...
Nope.
Chicken nuggies and mac and cheese?
Euros?
Why would I... That's... No.
That's meat.
Guys, come on. Here's the best thing to do. Let's start with a pizza place and go from there, okay?
A pizza place.
All right. Well, this pilot may have been rough, but it's always a smooth flight here on Couch Pilots. I think Brian said that earlier, a smooth flight. Thanks, everyone. We'll see you next time.
Thank you, guys. And thank you for petting my dog for like the past 40 minutes. I appreciate it.
We'd like to thank you for joining us on this trip, and we are looking forward to seeing you on board again in the near future. Have a nice day.